Hi, this is Amy Roloff from Little People Big World, and I'm talking with you on Truth is Scary.
Truth is scary.
One of my concerns are, as I travel a lot more through speaking engagements, through my charity foundation, and even through my crazy show, Little People, Big World, is that the increased security issues that we have to go through as a traveler. The whole TSA thing, suddenly we have to go through body searches, go through these scanner things, and they know a lot of, you know, details about you personally as an individual. And you don't know who's exactly watching those screens, and to randomly be patted down for no reason, just because maybe what ifs, possibilities that you might be having something dangerous on your personal body. I just personally think that America has slowly eroded their own freedoms and choices away. And once you start doing that, you start going down a different road, and you can't get back. You can't get those freedoms back, because once someone has it, once someone has taken them away, they're gone forever. I don't think we're ever going to get away from, you know, these intense security lines and issues that we have to go through when we're in the airport. But I think the TSA, the personal pat downs, I think has gone a little bit extreme, especially those people who have health issues that no one really knows about. But then you've got to explain it to a stranger that who is this person that has the ability to, you know, go up and down the leg, through the chest, you know. And the other thing is, how many people have we really gotten? That information has never really been out. What's the percentage of people that we have really prevented from doing some dangerous things via airplanes? And some of the issues that I've read about is that pilots and steward and flight attendants are saying that they shouldn't have to go through it all the time because they go through it all the time. But I'm like, well, first of all, why not? Because there might be a possibility that one time that they don't, maybe someone has approached them and asked them to do something, and they didn't have to go through the security and the pat downs and through the body scan things. It's like, if we have to do it, so should they. Anyone on the plane has to do it each and every time they get on that plane. I've read something else that if you have a businesswoman who happens to be in a suit, which is a skirt and a jacket, that they can't pat that person down in a skirt. So they have to go to a separate room, change, wrap themselves up with something that they can be patted down. I'm like, really? It's a little bit too much. And I have my own personal reasons and things that I think a personal pat down is a violation of my personal space. I think we don't have a choice as American people to make that decision. And to have to explain something to someone else that has no medical background, is a complete stranger, and you don't know what they're going to do with that type of information, I just think it's gone overboard. It's unnecessary. Bullying is a huge issue nowadays, more so than when I was growing up. I mean, I've definitely been bullied. I've been teased. I've been harassed, you know, walking on the way home from school. But I knew who this person was. They had a face. Verbally, I could see them. I think the bullying now with these young kids and how much all of these young kids are going through, whether it be, you know, image, whether it be, you know, a lot of personal issues are going through their family, whether it be divorce or something like that, with the technology that's available to them. A lot of people can hide behind blogs now. Some of these kids may go to a big school, never know half these people, but because they've got access to Facebook or MySpace or emails and these names that are associated with these blog spots, you don't really have to divulge your name. So it's a lot easier for the person to bully because it's not personal to them. They're very detached from it. So they can't see the hurt, the pain that a lot of these kids are going through. And it's a horrible situation. And whether parents need to be really, you know, looking out in a different way with their kids on the technology, or really being a little bit more involved in what their kids are doing. Who are they associating with? What groups at school are they involved in? I'm not quite sure. A lot of the emphasis has been on the person that's being bullied, but I also want to take a note to say, why is a person wanting to bully someone else? What is going on in their life that they feel this need to hurt someone so much unless they themselves are hurting and this is their way of, you know, lashing out or making their own pain go away? But it's a sad to see what's happening with these young kids and them feeling that they have to take their own life. And, you know, the emphasis, unfortunately, has been on some of these young people who are noted to be gay. But to me, it's not a matter of whether race, whether faith, whether religion, whether you're gay orientation or whatever it is. The fact that bullying is outright wrong. It's going to become a much bigger problem, I think. And I think everyone has to be involved to help detour that. The environment is very important to me. I love going hiking. I love going canoeing. I've done that all of my growing up life. I've gone camping. To be able to go to parks and see trees and, you know, rivers and just to be able to experience that, I think is very important. And I think everyone should have that opportunity to go experience that kind of natural beauty around us. I also think that we sometimes can go to extremes, meaning, you know, don't do anything. You know, to the one end that we're destroying everything just by walking, you know, in the forest or the woods. Or you go through the other end, it's like, oh, do whatever you want with the environment. It'll rebound or whatever they do. The extremes is not where we should be at. We definitely have to make a conscious effort as to how do we care for the planet and where we live in our environment. Through my charity foundation, we have partnered with Generosity Water. I've gone to Haiti. And just with the devastation that they've been through, just the fact that these people can't even turn on a faucet because they don't have any, just to have clean water that they're washing in the same water that they're drinking from, or doing dishes or bathing in it or whatever it may be. The fact that they don't even have basic clean water is why I wanted to do a well. The devastation that happened in the Gulf through BP and the horribleness of the oil rig that, you know, spilled all this oil around. For these major companies to benefit so much financially from being able to do that in the Gulf, but then turn around and not take the responsibility that, yes, this happened. We need to do whatever we need to do in order to clean it up. Instead of passing the buck, instead of saying, well, you know, because we're here, you know, the Gulf area needs to take care of it, or the United States needs to take care of it. It's like, people, there's a lot of regular, everyday people who make a living from the ocean, rightfully so, and they're suffering the consequences so much more environmentally wise, you know, their livelihood, economic, just because of maybe some fault, maybe neglect, or maybe the lack of responsibility that a company is taking in order to clean up this mess. This is going to destroy that area for a long, long time, probably more so than we even realize right now. And not to make that important, but to shove it off as, oh, it'll rebound, it's happened before, or whatever it may be, I just think it's wrong. I think we're getting worse and worse when accidents like this happen and we don't take care of it right away. It's going to affect us a lot longer environmentally, more so than we've ever realized in the past.